Vulnerabilities to improving low-level defenses. Please give a warm 34C3 welcome to Benjamin and Philipp.
Thanks for the intro. Thanks for coming. Today we present our research on microcode. This is joint work with our colleagues and our supervisors from Ruhr University Bochum. First of all, I want to give a small disclaimer. The technical details in this talk are quite specific to AMD K10 and K8 processors. The newest release processor that our staff works with is from 2013. And also, most of the findings are from reverse engineering. So if you want to replicate the experiments at home, please proceed at your own risk, because we may trigger unintended behavior in the CPU. So let's get started. First of all, we want to grasp a general idea what microcode really is. We want to give an architectural crash course. We want to thoroughly explore the question whether it's hackable. And in the end, there will be some demo time. So first of all, what's microcode? If this is your CPU, you can imagine microcode to be a small computer within your CPU, which does all sorts of complex things that we will cover in this talk. And we will see how we can deal with it. So first of all, I want to give some previous work. First of all, there are AMD patents that are publicly available, and they give a good general overview of the microarchitectural details. So then there's the website Chip Architect, and there is a rather detailed article about the physical placement of specific components on the die of the chip. Then there is the anonymous blog post from 2004, Opteron Exposed. And basically, it reveals for the first time that microcode is updatable and that some AMD CPUs even accept microcode if they are modified and the checksum is corrected. So this basically was the initial idea of our research. Then there's a paper, Security Analysis of x86 Processor Microcode. They cover mostly security stuff related about microcode updates from Intel and AMD processors, and give a general overview. So then there's the work of Arrigo. He probably has some internal knowledge. And is also doing really cool stuff with AMD microcode. So now that we know what microcode is and what related work there is, let's have a look at what it's actually used for. So first of all, it's used for instruction decoding. It's used to fix bugs in CPUs that are in the field already, so they are already rolled out. It's used for exception handling on the architectural level. So if there is a division by zero, for example, the CPU somehow needs to detect that and pass the exception and the information to the operating system. And this is handled in microcode. Also, microcode is used for power management within the CPU and can be used by the vendors to implement complex CPU features like Intel SGX, for example. So we heard that microcode is used for instruction decoding. And we now want to see why this is. So the x86 instruction set architecture is quite complex. it is a variable length instruction set, as you can see here. There's an instruction with 1 byte and an instruction with several bytes. And usually, the first byte indicates how long such an instruction is, which helps during the decoding process. But of course, there's an exception to this. There are instruction prefixes, which delay the decision how long the instruction is going to be 1 further byte. And on top of that, there are several of those, and they can also be applied combined to form all kinds of complex instructions. Also, there are instruction set extensions. Here we have a vector floating point addition and subtraction with packed single precision floating point units. And this instruction has several operands and is quite complex to decode. And later on, also quite complex to execute or to be executed within the CPU. And due to this complexity, we need a small computer within our CPU to actually decode this. Now we are going to have a quick look at how this decoding looks like. We have an x86 instruction on the left, pop EBX dereferenced. And this instruction gets decoded to several microcode instructions or micro ops. On the right, you can see those. At first, we read the top of the stack and load this value in the temporary register. Afterwards, this register gets stored in the location indicated by EBX. And afterwards, the stack pointer gets incremented. So we also just heard that microcode is used to update CPUs that are erroneous and that are already in the field. And this behavior probably is motivated by the infamous Intel Pentium FDIF bug in 1994, where certain Intel Pentium processors would produce slightly off results for certain floating point operations. This was quite a mess, and Intel had to pay a ton to replace processors in the field. So both Intel and AMD wanted to avoid this in the future and added updatability. So one example, this year, there was this Intel Kaby Lake bug where certain hyper-threading behavior or certain hyper-threading conditions would lead to unstable system behavior. And this bug was fixed with a microcode update. So then we had on the AMD side also some bugs. There was an AMD Phenom bug in 2008 where TLB entries could not be cached reliably. And this bug was also fixed with microcode. So again, quite recently this year, there was an AMD RISM bug, which also got fixed by microcode. So let's now have a look at the inner workings of the microarchitecture and how microcode is embedded within that. So an instruction gets executed on the CPU. And first, it gets from the main memory to the caches. And at some point, it gets to the decode engine and gets decoded to microops there. The microops are then scheduled, possibly reordered, to the pipeline. And the pipeline then leverages the numerous functional units, like an arithmetic logic unit or address generation units, in parallel to actually execute the micro instructions. We now zoom into the decoder and have a closer look there. We have the instruction buffer that stores the current stream of bytes and several other kinds of decoders. We have short decoders that can each translate one simple x86 instruction to one micro-op and pack them together and put this packed together thing into the scheduler. Then we have the long decoder, which is able to translate complex or more complex x86 instructions into several micro-ops. Now we get to the most interesting decoder, which is the vector decoder on the very right. This decoder contains the microcode engine and an x86 instruction that gets decoded by the vector decoder actually triggers a small microcode program to be run within the CPU. And this microcode program may generate an arbitrary number of microops that then get scheduled to the pipeline and executed. So we just heard that within the CPU, certain micro programs are run. So they need to be stored somewhere. And there's an on-chip ROM, the microcode ROM, which stores the microcode and basically also the micro programs. So then we have microcode RAM. During runtime, the CPU can get a microcode update. And the microcode update gets stored in the microcode RAM that you can see there. Then there's all kinds of circuitry around to make the whole thing working. For example, the addition unit that increments the program counter for the microcode engine. And most importantly for us are the match registers. They basically provide us with breakpoints in the microcode ROM. And those breakpoints can be set at certain microcode ROM addresses. And once such an address gets executed, the control is redirected to the microcode RAM, where the microcode update is stored. This is a very important mechanism for microcode updates to actually get control of things happening in the CPU and changing behavior, like sanitizing inputs for instructions, for example. So how do we actually update the microcode for a CPU core? Well, we need to be in kernel mode. We need to load the microcode update into the RAM. And we need to write the virtual address of the update into the given machine-specific register. As the microcode update gets loaded into the microcode RAM, those updates are not persistent. And once you reboot or reset the CPU, it's in its initial state again. So the microcode update file format, you can see here. It contains an header with several fields, such as state, patch ID, a checksum. And this is followed by the match registers, which contain the contents for the breakpoints. And afterwards, the microcode follows. The microcode is followed, organized in so-called triads. And one triad contains three microops and one sequence word. The microops are actually microcode instructions that execute code. And the sequence word is for control flow redirection. So now we want to answer the question whether this is hackable. So we learned it's updatable. We have update drivers in different BIOSes and also the Linux kernel. So we know the procedure, how to update. We have original microcode updates by the vendors. They are distributed through BIOS updates. Core boot also has quite a huge collection of them. We know the update file format. And there are hints that there is no strong cryptography protecting the integrity of the microcode updates. So this is a hex dump of one of the microcode updates. I just want to have a quick glance. We can see here a repeating value over and over way too often. And if we color more values that are the same values, we can basically see patterns emerging. So meaning we have no strong crypto applied there. And we've learned that the CPU accepts modified update if the checksum is corrected. So yes, it's hackable. At this point, we knew that we had to generate a lot of microcode updates in an automatic manner. To be able to trigger behavior change and from that behavior change learn of the inner workings. So we built a framework, and the framework contains out of nodes. The nodes run our own custom written x86 operating system. That's a very low noise environment, so we control all instructions that get executed. And the operating system runs on computers powered by AMD processors. So the nodes are connected to a Raspberry Pi via serial for data communication, and we use the GPIO pins connected to the reset and power switches on the main boards to automatically power up and down and reset the nodes, because when the nodes execute random microcode, they often hang and are not recoverable. So the whole setup is reachable from the internet to have remote access, and just as a convenience feature. So this is what it looked like in the very beginning at our home. This is what it looked like later at university. And now we have the tools for automated testing, and we use that for generating heat maps. The name is a little bit misleading. Let me just explain what we refer a heat map as to. Basically, it's a mapping from microcode ROM addresses to the corresponding x86 instruction. So an x86 instruction is implemented in microcode, and the microcode is located at certain ROM addresses. And the map basically says which ROM address implements what x86 instruction. We generated the heat maps by iteratively hooking all microcode ROM addresses with the breakpoint registers and then executing all x86 instruction. So once we have the heat maps, we can reliably execute our own bits as microcode by just setting the breakpoint register to a known location and executing the corresponding x86 instruction. Then the control gets redirected to our own microcode in the update, and we can just put random bits there, and the CPU will interpret these random bits as microcode and execute it. So because there is no documentation on the microcode instruction set, we basically had to conduct an unknown instruction set analysis with a black box model, because there's no publicly available assembler, disassembler, compiler, or any documentation. But luckily, we had an Oracle, the CPU itself. We can just feed it inputs and observe the outputs. And from the differences in behavior, we can infer structure, encoding, and meaning. So we now have a quick look at how the CPU Oracle looks like. First, we feed it an x86 instruction. And we feed it an initial state, which basically contains out of values in x86 registers. And we feed it a microcode update that we've generated on our own. The match register is a corresponding match register to the x86 instruction that we execute, so that the micro ops that are also contained in microcode update that we fill with random bits get executed by the CPU. Afterwards, we get an output state that basically mirrors the state the CPU is in after it executed our random bits as microcode. Very often, when the CPU executes random bits as microcode, the CPU would just crash, and sometimes we would see no difference in the input state and the output state. After some weeks of brute forcing, pretty much, we finally got to a bit string that would not crash the CPU, and that would yield a difference in input and output state. And this basically was our early attempt and initial step for further analysis. Now, of course, we want to know what this bit string is actually doing. So what operation is it executing? And to get that, we started to toggle one bit by one bit in the bit string that we found randomly. And here we change bits on the very right, and we saw that the output changed again. And after changing the bits on the very right several times and looking at the outputs and inputs, we finally concluded that this bit string represents an EAX at immediate instruction on microcode level. So we then used that knowledge to build a small database of opcode operands and opcode fields. And here you can see that we determined the length of the immediate opcode field and put it there. So if we change other bits, like some bits more to the left, we get other outputs. And we already know on the very right the immediate field. If we change the immediates, the EAX output changes again, but it changes differently. And if you look at the binary representation of the inputs and outputs, we can, after several attempts, can infer that we found an XOR. So after some more testing, we found that the operation field has a certain length that can be seen on the slides. And this was basically our starting point. And we leveraged the framework to conduct a lot of automated testing, where we sometimes more randomly, sometimes less randomly, toggled bits and selected bits. And we filtered the outputs to be interesting, so that we only had to look at a few set of outputs. And interesting outputs are the CPU didn't crash. There are changes in behavior. We also had to manually filter out some random noise that's sometimes occurring. And then, after a lot of work, don't worry if you can't read it, we got to this. So we have quite an exhaustive list of operation fields that are sometimes immediate, sometimes registers, or size fields, and if flags get propagated or not, and so on. So one other thing that we wanted to conduct is to infer the logic of microcode ROM triads. So triads that are stored in the microcode ROM, we can't read them because they are in microcode ROM areas on the die itself. So we wanted to indirectly infer the behavior of some of those. We first used a breakpoint register at a known address to get initial control. We would then execute the corresponding x86 instruction to get control in our first microcode RAM stage. And we would then write microcode in our update to jump back to microcode ROM to exactly this ROM address that we want to analyze. We then add one to this address and put this address into another match register to jump back to our microcode ROM, RAM, so our second microcode RAM stage. And this would then output the results so that we can compare input and output state again. But this time we didn't execute our own random or less random bit string, but we executed a microcode triad that's stored on the ROM. This approach has several drawbacks. For one, the microcode ROM triad might just modify some internal CPU state that we don't know, so we can't really observe it or grasp it. And another disadvantage is that the microcode ROM triad may not execute the triad one address further, but it may just jump somewhere else in microcode ROM. In this case, we would lose the control, but we designed our microcode ROM stage to not notice this, and so we would just try another microcode ROM triad in this case. So quite late in our project, we decided to give it a try and read the microcode ROM from the CPU die itself. So we decapped the chip and delayered the chip and took a die shot, looks like this. Maybe you can see in green the microcode ROM areas. So they take quite a bit of the CPU surface. If you zoom in a little bit more with a scanning electron microscope, you can start to see bits and patterns. And if you zoom in even more, you can see white dots that are either a little bit more to the left or to the right. That means they are either connected to ground or to VCC. And that in turn means that this specific ROM cell is representing either a 1 or a 0. We used optical character recognition to get, let's say, most of the bits out. And we could actually, after some rearranging, because the physical layout is a little bit strange, to us software guys at least, we could actually find microcode instructions in there. It's still a challenge, though, to us to get the exact mapping from the physical layout to the microcode ROM addresses. So let's recap our reverse engineering results real quick. So we generated those heat maps. We found in total 29 micro ops. So these are logic, arithmetic operations, memory load and stores. We can write the x86 program counter, and we have a microcode conditional branch. So we also reverse engineered the features of the sequence word. For example, it can be used to just execute the next triad. It can be used to signal sequence complete, which means that the decoding of the current x86 instruction is completed and that the next x86 instruction will be executed. The sequence word can also be used to branch within microcode unconditionally. Then we also found the substitution engine. And the substitution engine can be used to automatically put operands that are in the x86 instruction to the microcode instruction, so that an EAX in x86 instruction would automatically be EAX in the microcode instruction as well. This heavily simplifies the implementation of x86 instructions in microcode. So we also want to augment x86 instructions. Until now, we can just replace the logic of an x86 instruction by setting a breakpoint register to the entry point and writing our own microcode there. But we also wanted to extend existing logic and preserve the original semantics. And we can do that by either jumping back to ROM to execute the original triads, or for simpler x86 instructions, we can also emulate instruction logic ourselves. And there are some examples. So once we reverse engineered the x86 microcode instructions, or some of it, we started to implement our own microcode programs. And the first microprogram that we wrote is a simple instrumentation, which is just a proof of concept, more or less. It pretty much just in microcode counts how often a certain x86 instruction was executed. Another instrumentation that we implemented is a small framework that allows to hook x86 instructions and redirect control to an arbitrary function that's implemented in C, for example. We also implemented some remote microcode attacks. So given a backdoored CPU that has the backdoor implemented in microcode, if the computer visits a website, it may trigger the backdoor, and we implemented sample websites that can trigger such a microcode backdoor. And we have two versions available. One is implemented with ASM.js and one with WebAssembly. We also implemented some micro programs that contain cryptographic trojans, so they are harder to detect. And the microcode, the cryptographic microcode trojans either introduce a timing side channel in a constant time ECC implementation, or they allow to inject faults to enable fault attacks on cryptographic primitives. So now we want to have a quick look at how such microprogram looks like. The microprogram is given in our own register transfer level language that we developed to implement microprograms efficiently so that we don't have to put together long streams of bits on our own. So the first instruction you can see is a subtraction that's actually used as a compare. So the value in T1D, which is a microcode internal register, is compared to the value in EAX. Afterwards follows a conditional jump. And we want to first consider the jump not taken path. That's here. This is just a couple of instructions that set up an integer division. And here we see in the very last instruction that we jump back to the microcode ROM. So what's happening in this case is that we mimic the setup of an integer division, and then we jump back to the original triads in ROM to just continue the normal integer division process. Now we consider the jump taken path, which only gets executed if the value in EAX matches the value in T1D. In this specific case, we add 1 to the program counter, and then we write this value to the x86 program counter. So this basically means this microcode backdoor, if you will, would compare EAX to a certain magic value. And if that certain magic value is found, then the x86 program counter would be incremented by 1, which means that all successive x86 instructions will be executed out of alignment or disaligned. This is a very useful primitive that can be used for JavaScript exploits, for example, without the presence of a browser bug. So now it's demo time, and I'm handing the stage to Benjamin.
Okay, so. First of all, I have an EPC with me that is running an old AMD CPU. And it is actually a CPU we can target with our microcode programs. And at first, I'm going to quickly walk you through the program that's actually currently loaded inside the CPU. And I booted your standard Linux on it. And yes, it's just some microcode backdoor. And first, you load the value that you want to trigger on. And then you perform some magic to condense it down to 1 bit if you actually trigger this value. And the actual magic happens here. You read out what is written inside a buffer in memory. And why this is important, you'll see in a second when I show you the actual JavaScript payload we're going to run. But essentially, you read out some memory and place it inside a temporary register and perform an arithmetic on it. And then you implement the actual semantics of shift right double, which is an x86 opcode. And you do this because if your trigger value didn't match, you don't want to cause any trouble, because sometimes the kernel might use this instruction, or some other application on your host system might use this instruction. So it is important to preserve the semantics if you don't want to trigger a backdoor. So at this point, we know whether or not to trigger, and we can now conditionally add some values to registers or otherwise modify them. And we do exactly that. And at first, we conditionally set EAX to 11, which happens to be the exec-ve syscall on Linux. And then you set some other registers that we need to actually launch the system call with the arguments we control. And you do this for multiple registers. And in the end, you conditionally write the program counter to a specific value given actually in the JavaScript payload. So with the JavaScript payload, you can choose where you want to go. And this all happens conditionally. It only triggers if an input to this instruction matches our magic constant. And how did we achieve it? This is a WebAssembly module, and I carefully crafted some calculations that contain disaligned x86 instructions. And as you can see, we end with an interrupt into a kernel, so we trigger an exequy system call. And the buffer we're reading from is shown here. And essentially, we just say, please pop us a calc. And this is an unmodified Firefox. And I haven't added any code to it. And it's not running a vulnerable version, as far as I know. So I just press calculate. And because I attach a debugger, we're going to break here in a second. Need to wait a bit because this EPC is actually really slow, especially if you're debugging Firefox. And there we go. Now I'm just going to step through some instructions that are part of the hook I need to set in order to get the address I want to go to. And now we are inside the WebAssembly module I showed you earlier. This is all code that is emitted by Firefox during runtime. So an attacker is free to choose what code should be emitted by providing the appropriate WebAssembly module. And as you can see, this is the execution of our shift-right D opcode. And we actually backdoored this one. And what I took special care of is placing our constant inside an argument register. So actually, our backdoor will trigger. And because GDB is going to lose control in a second, I'm going to cheat a bit. And I know that we're going to jump 6 bytes more, so just add 6. And press continue. And we are disaligned inside instructions. And as you can see, we perform all the things we actually coded into the microcode to prepare the argument registers. And if you compare it to the WebAssembly output, I said, please emit this opcode, followed by a jump 5, and please emit, lastly, these 2 opcodes. And exactly these opcodes we have. So let's just continue and hope it works this time. And of course it didn't. Let me just quickly run it outside of GDB. And there you go, your basic X start. And as already said, we can also implement some cryptographic backdoors. And because I need to reboot for this to work, I'm going to show you the not triggering case first. So we have a standard signature verification, and it just says valid signature because everything is fine. But now we are going to quickly apply the backdoor. And request our custom kernel because we need to somehow apply the update. And while this actually reboots, I'm going to show you a different demo. I have this console is actually going to push a script to a Raspberry Pi currently sitting in the binary assembly in the CCL. And this is connected via Syria to an AMD node. And this is going to run the microcode we tell it to run. And first, I'm going to show you what happens if I just say, don't hook anything in the microcode. So you just go ahead and say, run it. And the register you should pay attention to is EBP. Currently, it's 0 because I didn't change anything. And now I'm going to say, OK, let's hook it. And suddenly something changed. And what changed is this is a microcode I pushed to the CPU. And all it does is push the next x86 instruction to be executed and store it on the stack and then just jump to a location I predefined. And this location ends up all the way over here. So we actually get control in x86 without having to write any like program rewriting stuff. It just works. So this is also something we can do. We can introduce lightweight microcode hooks. And actually, the EPC finished booting. So let me quickly set up VNC again. Okay, so again, we're on the EPC, but this time we booted a different update. For example, this update wouldn't trigger the backdoor we placed in Firefox, but instead, you're going to run the crypto demo you saw before again, and suddenly it says invalid signature because we introduced an error into the calculation that is performed during the elliptic curve calculation. And using this, you can actually perform the cryptographic attacks. And just a bit of theory. I introduced an cryptographic weakness into an otherwise secure crypto by introducing an arbitrary error. And using this, you can reconstruct key material. And all of this is done in microcode alone. I didn't need to modify the binary that is running. So that brings us. To security issues that actually occur with this setup. You can push any update as you saw. I mean, I modified it live, pushed it to the CPU, it accepted it. You can backdoor it as you saw, and you can't really fix it because you would need to do a hotfix record to introduce some proper cryptographic checking. And of course, you can hacky fix it. You just break the update mechanism. But in the end, it isn't that bad because you already have a really strong attacker model. Someone had to actually modify your BIOS to apply this on every boot up. So usually, this isn't a problem for you. And in the end, yes, microcode can be reversed, and you can change it. And if you want to talk a bit more about it or even try your hand at modifying microcode yourself, visit us at the CCL0. We are in the binary security assembly, and we have a setup with us, including this EPC and an old K10 that you can push it live. It runs our Angry OS. And also, we pushed our sample updates and trigger HTML files to GitHub, including an update driver where you can patch your own CPU. But please be careful. This can actually break your CPU. We didn't manage to break ours, but we managed to reset our BIOS settings at some point. So please be careful.
So now we have time for questions from the audience. You see microphones around the arena with numbers stuck on them. On the internet, we have a signal angel who is already telling me that we have questions from the internet. Before we get to the questions, I said in advance, you may be asked to leave the hall entirely when going back. And now I'm asking you that when you leave, please leave entirely and re-enter the hall through the main entrance. Not the hall, but the whole mess of here. So now from the signal angel in the internet.
Thank you. We had a question that came up quite early in the talk. Is it possible to cause physical damage to a CPU using malicious microcode? Has either of you, ever break the CPU?
We didn't break any CPUs, apart from the ones we decapped to put in the electron microscope. And maybe it is possible. We haven't managed it yet, but the design of at least the AMDs we analyze doesn't look like you can, unless there is some feature inside the microcode that you can trigger. We haven't found it yet. Maybe it's possible, but most likely it isn't.
Microphone 6.
Yes. Is it possible to fix performance issues with microcode?
So we've thought about that as well. For example, for binary instrumentation, there are several different approaches to that. You can emulate the code like Volcan is doing, for example. Or you can instrument the code statically. But they all have like drawbacks, like either they are slow or they are not complete, like the static rewriting, for example, at least not complete in general. So microcode can actually be a quite performant and complete instrumentation basis that an instrumentation framework could be based on. The problem with microcode, though, is that at the moment it's quite limited, because for newer AMD CPUs and pretty much for all Intel CPU, microcode is closed. But maybe the CPU vendors will open it up a little bit, and then it could be used to increase performance for instrumentation frameworks. It can also be used to implement new instructions. But I doubt that it's going to be way faster than if you just implement it in x86 instructions.
Microphone one.
Yes, have you looked at the older Intel microcode updates as well? Because if you look at them, they are like encrypted, but it's clearly not strong crypto. It's either a constant stream cipher or a small block cipher.
So
because also I have previously succeeded in actually loading patched microcode updates, so they have been able to control the contents, but so clearly the verification mechanism isn't very strong either.
So okay, we didn't have a close look into old Intel updates, but that's a very good question, and we should probably have a discussion offline. So feel free to visit us at the assembly, and then we can have a look together. Would be cool. Mm-hmm.
Microphone two.
How accurate is it to refer to the microcodes as a RISC architecture rather than CISC? I mean, are there any instructions in there you wouldn't typically find on a regular RISC architecture?
The question was whether is the reduced instruction set like architecture. So I can agree on that. The microcode instructions are mostly quite simple. One quite interesting feature actually is that you can have a three operand mode where you can give three registers, and you can have one destination register and two source registers, which is not possible on x86, as you all know probably, but it's possible at microcode level, so it's quite interesting. Mm-hmm.
Back to the Signal Angel.
Thank you. How do you know the microcode entry point for a given instruction?
That's a very good question. We showed you the heat maps, and we generate them by basically setting a breakpoint at each possible microcode ROM address, and then just trying all x86 instructions. And obviously, sometimes we would have multiple hits for one x86 instruction, because not one ROM address is enough to implement the whole x86 instruction. And what we then can do, we have 8 match registers, so we can set 8 breakpoints at once. We would just set 8 breakpoints at those different locations and see which one gets triggered first. And so we could actually step by step debug in which order microcode ROM addresses get executed to implement an x86 instruction. And so we, in this way, we also find the entry point.
Microphone three.
You said that those microcode updates are not persistent across reboot, right? Across processor reset. Mm-hmm. Does it mean that when a vendor issues a microcode update, it is actually a program, patched to a BIOS that should install the update on every reboot, even a boot sequence, right?
Yeah. So the CPU vendors, they don't publish those microcode updates, but they put them, or they give them to the mainboard vendors, and mainboard vendors usually put them into BIOS or UEFI updates. And those updates then contain the microcode updates, and during boot they get installed.
Also, there actually is on Linux the Intel microcode package, and this actually performs the microcode update on every boot. And I actually hijacked its driver to perform our custom update. So depending on the OS you're running, you either get it from your BIOS or you get it from your operating system.
Microphone four.
I wanted to ask, you mentioned it might be possible to use crafted Microsoft microcode update to actually patch out the update mechanism? Or how do you think it would be to implement that inside, say, Libreboot and make sure that the microcode update mechanism is patched out very early on in the boot process?
So this would actually be quite easy to do. It still requires some reverse engineering work on our side. But through the heat maps, we already have quite a good understanding where the microcode update mechanism is probably going to be, because once you set breakpoints there, you can't apply microcode updates anymore. So it would require some work there, but then it would be quite easy to just have a microcode update mechanism in Libreboot and very early in the boot disable the update mechanism. Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm.
Signal Angel.
Can you use this trick so that the CPU is revealing any secrets, e.g. keys, out of secure enclaves, like TPM-like entities in the CPU?
Probably not, at least not on AMD, but we can't really tell you the definitive answer to that, because the CPUs we can control don't have a secure enclave, so we didn't test it. And what we actually observed is that the microcode follows the same permissions that the codes that actually triggered the microcode. For example, if you have an MMU, the microcode will actually follow the memory protections you set. So most likely, no, but maybe. We can't tell you yet.
Microphone 2.
So you said you have 29 micro-ops. Do you know how much of the total space that supported this? So do you think there are some microcode instructions you didn't find yet, or is it all there is?
So it's very, very likely that we didn't find many of those instructions. There are still certain regions within the microcode instructions that we don't understand, and if you toggle them, it crashes or the behavior is different and we can't tell what operation it's doing. Also, we can just observe some of the registers, and we can't observe all the internal workings of the CPU. So a lot of instructions that modify the internal state of the CPU, let's say it enables or disables certain features, or enables and disables certain slow or fast path for some features. We don't notice that. And due to that, we can't, we don't know what the instruction is doing, what a bitstream is doing that we are testing currently. So probably there are many instructions we don't know.
Microphone 1.
Have you considered ways to say if my microcode is being backdoored, to detect that? Can you help me in that situation?
During our research, we didn't have a look into this yet, but we already had some internal discussions regarding this point. It's a really good question. So if you use microcode to hook an x86 instruction, you introduce a small timing overhead. And if you carefully measure that instruction, you can probably detect that suddenly this x86 instruction is doing more than it should actually do. So you can detect most of it. But it also depends. Microcode is doing not only decoding, as we've seen in the talk, but also other things in the CPU. So you might be able to hide trojans there that are not detectable that easily.
Microphone 2 again.
Okay. Considering that you can basically re-implement instructions, could you implement a completely different instruction set?
Yeah, you could do that. And I showed you in the related work the Trubos talk from Arrigo, and he is actually doing something like this. So yes, it's possible. We are still not far enough with our knowledge to do that, but he has some internal insights.
Microphone two.
Okay, two questions actually. The first is, have you found any ways to trigger the coprocessors that x86 has plenty of?
So, let's say floating point unit and other extensions, right? We didn't look into that, but from the AMD patents, we know that there must be some way to do it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and second question, at the decoding, those short operations you showed, are they not going to this micro-op cache and through this micro-op decoding, and they're directly emitting those instructions? So are they safe in my code and cannot be altered?
So the short decoders, they translate simple x86 instructions, and we know that there's also a way to hook not microcoded instructions, so they are not safe. We know that this mechanism exists, but we didn't find it yet.
Microphone one.
Hi. Maybe you said it, but I missed it. But did you contact Intel? Did you get any feedback?
So we did not contact Intel. We contacted AMD. This work is also published on Usenix, and way longer than 90 days before, we sent them the results and the findings, and asked for feedback. They didn't communicate much with us, probably because they already have an up-to-date, secure, or more or less secure, we don't really know, but strong crypto protection mechanism for microcode in place for their latest CPU architectures. So they were probably not that interested in this. Mm-hmm.
All right, great. Let's give our speakers another big round of applause.
Thanks very much.